I will talk about some recent research about some rankings. Joint work with Miao Philips and Sebastian Zibet, which are in the Warsaw. Okay, so the whole story is about some sparsification of dense graph classes. It is a very simple example, is that there are two graphs, where one is complete graphs and the other is stars. So generally we have some dense graphs, and then we want to represent these graphs by some sparse graphs. So here this meaning is that from the right hand graph, if you say that you add an edge between the two vertices with this and Samos 2, then you will create the complete graphs under this independence, right? So and then if you remove the one vertex, then you will find this graph. Somehow, the general some project is that we have some dense graph classes that are not studied before, and then this class we want to represent by some sparse graphs in certain way. So this power, this two distance power, is a kind of example of a representation, but there are lots of things to be considered. But in this talk, we will consider only for this R power of graphs. And then the second thing is that if you have this representation, what kind of properties we can obtain. So this is some hierarchy of sparse graph classes, which have been recently discussed. And you probably will know about these graphs of bounded trees, and graphs of planar graphs, and then they are all generalized to some excluding a minor class. Where planar graphs, you don't have a K5, K33 doesn't have a K5 and K33 as a minor, and bounded trees also characterized by minor obstructions. And then Necetri and Osona de Mendes generalized these classes into a class of bounded expansion and nowhere dense classes, which are kind of extreme classes of these sparse classes. And I just want to remark that all these classes do not contain the infinitely large complete graphs. So when you fix, sorry, arrow means that the below guy is properly contains the upper guy. So like planar graphs are bounded genus, but not all bounded genus are planar. All these guys are very studied among 10 years before. But we have still interesting classes, but maybe contains some arbitrary large complete graphs, so doesn't fall into any of these classes. And then, so we have some simple question where that what can you say for these classes?
Sorry, just for everyone.
Yeah.
What do you mean locally?
Okay, locally usually meaning that for every vertex and then for every radius four, so you have this property. In general, like a locally bounded trees, meaning that you look at the vertex and then you look at the four, then you have bounded trees. But in the whole graph, you don't have to have a bounded trees.
And sir, what does this last line mean? Does it contain infinitely large complete graphs?
So when you fix a planar graph, like planar graph doesn't contain, when you fix any class of bounded expansion, so this class doesn't contain just some large complete graphs as a minor. Arbitrary large, yeah. But there is some fixed R such that you don't contain. Okay, so the first approach was first classes that was considered is that the map graphs. So map graphs they motivate us to look at these kind of problems, because map graphs is the definition is that starting from some planar graph, and you put the vertex for each face, and then you add an edge between these facial vertices if their faces are met. to each other. So this planar, original planar graphs looks like this, and then, yeah. So you can easily see that this map graphs contains arbitrary large complete graphs because many faces meet at the one vertex, right? One point, like. But this graphs contains of arbitrary large complete graphs, but somehow it should be similar to the planar graphs, right? It's just a modification. So it obtained from the planar graphs in a very simple way. So we expect that this class should satisfy some nice property. And then we want to look at this. Okay, we will talk about some properties of these graphs. And then, okay, before going this, we will look at the bounded expansion class, which was one of these sparse classes. And then from this, we will obtain some properties. So there are two nice properties. They bounded expansion classes admit the low tree scalar lengths and weak R-carrying numbers. So I will introduce what are these concepts. So generally, we are looking at some partition problem. So this is very abstract thing. Like you want to partition the graph into some pairwise vertex disjoint subgraphs where each graph has just some nice property, right? Like if you require each graph to be an edgeless graph, then this is a K-coloring problem. But what if you require more than this? Like you want to partition the K guys where any union of J guys satisfies some property. So this is some generalization of the first kind of partition problem. And then there are some motivation of this kind of partition problem. Like you want to test some fixed graph as a subgraph. You have some target graph H, and then you want to test whether a given graph contains this graph as a subgraph. And suppose we can find this kind of partition where J is equal to the size of H, right? Number of vertices of H. And then this good property implies that you can test the existence of this H in the polynomial time. Then obviously you can look at the every J union of these guys, and then you can easily test whether there is a H, right? Okay. So this kind of partitioning problem naturally related to the coloring problems, like if you think about the coloring problem of the first kind, then this is like a usual proper coloring problem, right? But for the second, like second theorem, there is a theorem by Borodin that every planar graph can be partitioned into five subgraphs where every two guys will be a forest.
Maybe if you want to be precise, you want to partition the vertex set into five sets, so that every union of two vertices induces a forest.
Yeah.
That could be...
Yeah, any union of two subgraphs. Yes, vertex set can be partitioned into five. Yes.
So it's induced. You take the union of any...
Union of the disk. Yes, right. Yeah, that's right.
Otherwise, initially, five subgraphs are empty graphs, and union of any empty graphs is empty, so... Makes sense.
Yeah. Well, I say partition, so probably, yeah. Okay, so what we naturally think about is that because of forests are graphs of tree with one, yeah, I will say tree, the definition of tree with, can you generalize this statement to the larger tree with value, right? You want to, and then also we need to consider the more parts maybe. And then like we say that there is some number so that any union of 10 parts have some tree with at most 10. Like is there some number that planar graphs can be colored by so many numbers? maybe 1,000 or 10,000. And then any 10 parts have 3 with them most 10. Can you partition like this? Okay, before going this, I just recapture the 3 with shortly. So 3 decomposition of a given graph is that you want to assign a vertex subset of the original graph into a tree-like way. So that, of course, every vertex should be contained in somewhere. And then for every edge, 2 vertices are contained in some same bed. And then if you look at the one special vertex, then the bags containing this vertex should be connected in the 3D composition. And then width of this decomposition is maximum size of a bag, -1, and 3 width is the minimum width sum of 3D composition. And especially, we want to say that this bounded 3 width is a good, nice property in the sense that you can test the subgraph isomorphism in the efficiently, right? Okay. So there are some interesting concept called the row 3 width coloring. So this is a central concept in this talk, so you should understand this. So a class of graphs satisfy admits the row 3 width coloring if there is a function only depending on this class, such that for every integer p, every graph in the class can be partitioned, vertex set of graph can be partitioned into f of p parts. So f is some function depending only on c, such that any union of I, which is at most p parts, has 3 with at most I minus. So this means that, like if you give me any integer like 1,000, so you have some huge number, but only depending on this class, such that so you can color every graph by this number of parts, such that any union of 1,000 parts have 3 with 1,000. So this is quite strong. So you might ask, is there some class satisfying this property? Necessary and also the Mendez proved that the actual planar graphs satisfy this property. So for planar graphs, you can do this for every value of p. So they introduced this class of bounded expansion class, and bounded expansion classes are exactly the graphs admitting these low trees columns, and then properly contains planar graphs. There are some classes which are not planar graphs and then bounded expansion.
So can you show us an example of this planar graph low tree width coloring for the grid?
For the grid?
Yeah.
Okay.
So it means for an arbitrary large grid, there is some number of parts that can partition.
Yeah, grid is easy because you give in P and then you just color the every column consecutively, you take a p plus 1 colors from the each columns, and then you take a p colors, then this is disconnected by somewhere, right? Among p plus 1. But in generally, you need some arguments, I guess. Okay. Yeah. So this bounded expansion class is it's characterized by several concepts. Expansion we need to introduce. And usually people take a shallow minus as definition of these classes. Shallow minor is that you want to take a minor, but each connected graph to be contracted it has a bounded diameter. And then what say is that for every R, there is some N such that every R shallow minors doesn't have a KN as a KN as a shallow minor. I will skip because there are too many. But I want to introduce a weak coloring number because this will be connected to our result. So weak coloring number? is that you have some linear order of the vertices. Like, I will give us some simple example. Like this. And then, okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And then you give me some linear order of the vertices, like 3, 1, 4, 5, 2. And then I want to define this weak reachable set by for fixed some vertex V. And R is also some given. So let's say R is 2 here. And then V, okay, I will say V3, V1. Yeah. So what is a pi? Pi 2, no. So weak like V5. Is that you collect some vertices in the previous vertices that appeared the previous of V5, such that you can reach this vertice by some passes like this, such that this length is at most R. And then this last vertex is the vertices among smallest vertices among all of these paths, vertices in the path. Right? Okay, like if you have a some path like this, then this guy is not contained the weak reachable set, because if you follow this path, then this is the smallest guy, and then this is not the smallest guy. So probably there are some paths like this, then you will put this vertex into the set. But if you only have this path, then you will not contain, you will probably contain this vertex to the set. Does it make sense? Okay, probably I will, maybe I will try to draw the graph here. Like here, the graph is that V1, V2, V3, V4, V5. And V1, and then V3 and V5 are connected. Then from V5, V4 is in the set, because you can just go here, and then V3 you can also go here, and then V1 is also go here. So actually, every guys are the interesting vertices, but maybe. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. But I want to say that if you only have a path like this, and then you will not include this in the weak reachable set. And then what I want to define is that the resolve of this given ordering is that the maximum this weak reachable set. And then weak alkaline number is that the minimum is over all linear orders. You will take all linear orders, and then you will consider the minimum among these guys. So you want to minimize this size of the weak reachable set in the certain way. And then Sudinger proved that the class of graphs admits the low trees coloring, depending on if for every R, weak alkaline number is bounded. So this is if and on if, and then we can use this. Okay, and then, so what we wanted to do is that we want to, we just naturally adapt the idea of the row 3 scaling to the row Rehnquist scaling. So Rehnquist is a kind of with parameters which represent the tree-like structure in the dense graphs. And then, but Rehnquist only cares about some very beautiful classes. Some kind of graphs doesn't admit this. Actually, we wanted to plan to show that the map graphs admit the low Rehnquist color. That is what we want to show. And then actually we generalize this later. Okay, I just briefly captured what are the rank lists. So rank lists actually, if you don't know the rank lists fully, then you can just think like this. You want to take the rank list, you want to partition recursively partitioned into vertex partitions, so that the number of neighbors between the two parts are bounded. Like somehow, this described the situation where the these guys all have the same neighbors to the other guys, but it's possible that there are many vertices in here. But so here, just you have three kind of vertices that have different neighbors to the other side. And Rehnquist just want to measure that, so how many number of neighborhood types necessary to the properly divided into the parts. And like complete graphs and complete bipartite graphs have a similar Rehnquist. And actually, this rank of the matrix is used to count a number of neighbors. I will define concisely, very shortly, that you just look at this example. So you have some graph, and then so you look at some partition of the vertex set. Like I want to partition to the 8, 4, 5, 6, 7, and then 1, 2, 3. And then you take a sum matrix of the adjacent matrix, meaning that you put the 1 if they are adjacent, and then put the 0 if they are not adjacent. And then we want to compute the rank of this matrix over the binary field. The rank of this matrix, meaning that rank of this matrix is R, then there are only 2 to the R many different vectors in here, right? In the column vectors or row vectors each, right? Because we are looking at the binary field, and then you only have a 0 or 1 for the constants, right? So you only have 2 to the r combinations of the vectors. And then, so the decomposition scheme is that you have some ternary tree, and then you want to map the vertices to the leaves of this tree. And then for each edge, you measure the rank of the matrix induced by this partition. Because this is tree, so you have a vertex partition corresponding to each edge. And then you compute the rank of this matrix induced by this partition. And then maximum width is the width of this decomposition is the maximum width over these trees. And then rank width is the minimum width over decomposition. So you want to minimize the this width by this partition. We just modify the definition of the row Trivis colorings like this way. So the class of graphs admits the row Rehnquist colorings if there is a function, there are two functions n and q such that for every integer p, every graph, vertex set of every graph can be partitioned into the n of p colors. So the first large N is the corresponding to the number of colors that to be colored, and such that any union of P colors, I colors, where I is at most P, have a rank with Q of I. So in the row trees colorings, this Q of I was just I minus 1. But here, for Rehnquist, it was difficult to compute the exact I minus 1, so we just relaxed this value of the QI. But we just require that there is some function Q where for every P, so you give us some Rehnquist and most Q of P. Yeah. So probably you can ask me that which kind of classes have low Rehnquist colorings. And the simple thing is that Rehnquist is at most more or less Trivis. So every class admits the low Trivis colorings have a low Rehnquist color. You just take the same decomposition and then plan a graph about that. And of course, the graphs of bounded Rehnquist or the Mr. Rehnquist color. You don't need color, right? Yeah. Of course, so what we are interested in is that what other classes admit row rank scalings, especially they do not admit the low tree scalings and their rank is unbounded, then it's more interesting. Okay. So as I said, what the ask in the first moment is that the MAC graphs admits the row rank scaling. Yeah. Somehow it should be.
Can you repeat for me the definition?
Yeah, sure.
Of map graph.
Map graphs of that definition.
There's some regions and
yeah. So
section graph of these regions.
Yeah. So you have some given planar graph. So this is some given planar graph, and then so you put the vertex for each face, like this is the facial vertices, and then you add an edge if they share a vertex. So in this case, even these two guys, we will add them because the vertex is shared.
So it's like the intersection graph of the
faces. Yeah, because the face. Yeah. You can see like this. And second guy is that we consider the line graphs of planar graphs where line graphs is that you put a vertex for each edge and then you add an edge if they share a vertex. It's a kind of similar concept of MAC graphs, and they also contain arbitrary large complete graphs, right? Because you just have a star and then you take the line graphs, then you have a complete graphs, right? But very interesting observation is that these two guys, actually the induced subgraphs of two powers of some another planar graph. Right? So to see this, like in this case, what can you do is that, so you modify this graph by just adding an edge between the spatial vertices to the original vertices, like this. And you put it like this. And then you take the two power. So power means that you add an edge if there are distance at most two. But then, so you will add an edge between these two guys, everything. Yeah. So I will remove every this white vertices, so you don't need to consider. So exactly these blue guys are the will be add an edge. Edge will be added between these two blue vertices if the faces share, right? Faces share a vertex, meaning that you have this distance two passes between these faces. And then, right. For line graphs, you can easily see that this picture actually gives this. And so you put the vertex for each edge, and then new graph, if two edges share a vertex, depending on if they are distance at most two in the new graph. Right? And then somehow we conjecture, so we modify the problem that every two powers of a planar graph have a low rank scalar. This is sufficient proof because so you don't need to start with these planar graphs, but you have another planar graph, right? So you just look at the all planar graphs and then two powers of planar graphs. If they have a low rank scalarings, then map graphs or line graphs of planar graphs have a low rank scalarings. And then what we actually can prove this is that for every fixed integer r, you collect every r power of the graph actually admits the low rank scalarings. And then we also come up with the result that actually planar doesn't have any role here. So planar graphs can be replaced by any class admitting low tree scalarings. So this is our main result. Yeah. Yes. Any question about this statement? Yeah. Yeah.
So what about So I think these map graphs, they're a subclass of string graphs, right? But the string graphs, they satisfy this, maybe?
I think string graphs, so you just have some lines in the
lines
plane.
Lines connected things, yeah. And the intersection graph in the plane.
You mean, so you take...
Okay, so your first special case of your theorem was map graphs,
yes.
And they are subclass of string graphs, I think.
Yes, yes. Yeah. But so, I think even low tree scalaring doesn't admit. So I think string graphs doesn't admit a low tree.
You think they don't admit low tree with color?
Yes, I think so. But I'm not sure. Mm-hmm. Because string graphs are too general. I think, maybe. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. But maybe there are some between the string graphs and map graphs.
So map
graphs are quite
the,
Okay, as I said, we use these two packs, planar graphs admit the low tree scalaring and weak alkaline numbers, bounded weak alkaline numbers for every integer R. And so the important observation is that if G has tree with at most T, then R power of G actually have a bounded rank with. So probably, at the first moment, you can imagine that this is kind of trivial because if you have a bounded trivis and then you take R closer, then you have a bounded Rankis. So somehow, this should be trivial. But this is not the case because the main problem is that so if you look at some vertex at A, and then after taking the R closer, first taking R closer and then look at A, is not equal to the you first take A and then R closure, right? So you want to, so because some edge is added by this the outside of A, right? So you need to give us some information of that the two vertices in the A are actually in the distance at most R in the graph. So the strategy is that so you have some A with some small number of colors, and then so you want to find some larger vertex set, but still have some small set of colors, such that if you look at the A, and then if there are distance at most R, then there is some path in the whole the bigger set between the two vertices of the A. So how to include this set of A? And then this bigger set should have a small set of colors. So this is the main technical point of this. Okay, so this is just a recall. And then we want to give these functions n and q. And okay, we fix the small r and small p here. And this is just a recall. Before going to proof, I just introduced some refinement technique used in this proof. So suppose that there is some coloring. So here coloring means that some just function from the vertex set to the 1 to t. And we want to obtain some new coloring c prime from the c. But this new coloring, the each color is some subset of the original colors. Okay. So each color is like 1 to 3. Or 1 to 10 or something like this. So what do we do? Is that you take the linear order of the vertex set of the graph, witnessing this weak alkaline number. So here, R is some number. So it will be determined in the application. But here, just fix some R. And then the, we know that the, these planar graphs admit a bounded weak coloring number. So there should be some linear ordering with this weak coloring number. And then, the so now I want to describe the how to what integers will be added to the DC prime. So you look at the some vertex V, and then you look at the, this weakly reachable set, and then for so there are only bounded number of this guy, right? Only this many numbers in this set, and then so for every this color in the reachable set, so you will add this C prime V. This is the first procedure. And the second procedure might be slightly technical. Is that so you have some linear ordering of the vertices, and then you have two vertices V and W. And then they have a distance R, exactly R. And then there is some path of length R where the every internal vertex is appears in the after W. If there is some this kind of path with the length exactly R, then you just choose some vertex in, among the internal vertex, and then the, you will add so let's say C of G. So you will add this C of G to the C prime of this W, the ladder vertex. Okay, the first note is that so of course between the, these two fixed vertices, there might be many of the, these kind of paths, but you just choose only one path and then you only one vertex among these. Yeah, this is sufficient. Because of this, so you will add only one vertex for the, this guy. So like you have some another V prime with W in the same situation, and then you will add some another color maybe, but you will only add this weak coloring, weak whichever set of W. Yeah. So in the second step, you will only add this many numbers to the W. Is it clear? So, I mean that whenever you add an edge, so this V is should be contained in the weak reachable set. So for each vertex V, you will only at most one vertex like this. So you will add in total you will add this many number of colors to the this W vertex. So the observation is that in the new coloring, so for each vertex the size is at most the two times of weak coloring, because in the first step you will add this many number, and then the second case also you will add this number. And then, so what we want to do is that we want to, at this moment, we just want to hit this R path. Yep. Like, so as I said, I want to look at some vertex set A, and then I have a V and W. So I want to make some bigger set where that if you have a path of length at most R, then this bigger set contains some internal vertex of this path. I don't want to contain all of them, but I just want to contain the one internal vertex of some path of length exactly R. But what we can argue is that H is a subgraph induced by X many colors in the new coloring, C prime. Then there is some H prime induced by blowing up this many colors, such that for every two vertices in the original subgraphs, V and W, with the distance exactly R in the whole graph, then H prime contains some internal vertex of some path of length exactly between the V and W. So this is very easy because from the construction, because suppose you have a path of length R between V and W, then this path, like the first case is that this, if you look at any path of length R, then maybe the this path of length exactly R only contains the vertices of this. Then the second step will contain some vertex here, right? Because if you only have this kind of paths, then there is some path containing some internal vertex by a second step. And otherwise this path should contain some internal vertex in the remaining vertices, which appears before W. And then this vertex should be contains a weakly reachable set from the W. So, So this blowing up is that, so X colors from the C prime, and then you just take a union of all of these colors, all of colors from the C prime. Like a C prime is that one color is like a 1, 2, 4, and the other color is the 2, 3, 5, and so on. And then I take a union of all of this selected colors. Then this color, the size of the colors will be x times of this this many numbers. And those. And then what you do is that we do this procedure from the R to the 2. So you first take you take this refinement for R and then R minus 1 and so on and 2. And then you can somehow easy to show that you can generalize this concept to R path closure, meaning that now, so you have you from the small set, you can find some bigger set such that so color number is blow up by this because of the you just take this R path heater for every R to 2. So for each processor, you will product this 2 times weak coloring number. And then in the resulting set, if two vertices have distance R in the original graph, then you should find some length of R, exactly R between the V and W in the this constructed set. So this is because in this situation, if there is a path of length R, then in the first closure, you will take some internal vertex between this, right? And then second step, so we know that the distance between V and Z is less than R, right? And then this distance between W and Z become also less than R, right? Because this is the internal vertex of the exact path of length exactly R. And then R is the distance. So distance between the V and G and G and W is smaller. And then at some point, so you have a closure for the smaller value. And then between V and G, so you will find some internal vertex. And then, so in between W, G, so you will find also internal vertex and so on. And then also in between these two guys, so you have a smaller distance and so on. And then eventually you will find the sum path of lengths R between V and W in the final resulting set. So this is a color refinement technique. And then what you do for this is that you take a low trace coloring with a trivial value for P times D of R, where D of R is product of this number. So n is given by this low trivial coloring function, right? For this value, there is some big number that every color classes of these guys have trivial this, right? And then, so we follow this refinement technique for this coloring, and then you will obtain some C2 prime. And then it uses some number of colors, which is much larger than n even, but it's still some constant for fixed R. And then what you can observe is that, okay, you look at the sum H with a subgraph of P colors of the C2 prime. Then by this observation, so you have this P times the D of R colors, such that, which is R pass closure of the H. And R pass closure use this P times D of R colors. Then, so they have a tree with at most P of P times of D of R, because this number is this number, right? Implies by low tree with colorings. So this bigger set has a small tree with, and then their R closure should contain this H as an induced subgraph, because if two vertices have distance at most R, then there should be some path of length at most R in this R path closure. So you should realize this smaller graph from the bigger graph if you take R closure. And then this implies that the rank width of the smaller graph in the resulting set has the bounded rank width, and thus H also have a rank width small. So this implies that map graphs or line graphs or planar graphs have a low rank width colorings. Yeah, this is the whole line of proofs. And then probably you can think about what kind of classes that does not admit low rank width colorings. So in this direction, we proved that these two classes, interval graphs and permutation graphs, do not admit low rank width colorings. For this, we introduce we think that this is a new concept, but there is some similar concept in the other papers. But anyway, we introduce this concept. So this called the twisted chain graphs. The construction is like this. So this is a chain graph, maybe you know that. So it's a bipartite graph where the neighborhood can be linearly ordered by this subset relation. And so you take two disjoint union of chain graphs, and then so you want to identify one part and one part of these two distinct chain graphs, so that you have these two chain graphs. And then you want to identify this part and then this part in the middle. But so that, so in the chain graphs, you can linearly order these vertices, right? But somehow, so we draw these vertices in the grid way, so that this linear order follows in this order. And then from this, so this linear order follows the other direction. So this is kind of construction. And then you don't matter the what is in these three of the parts. So in each part, you may have an edge or not, but this is not important. So only these edges will imply that this does not meet the low rank frequency. So we proved that for any construction like this, this does not meet the low rank with colorings. And then, so you can model this twist chain graph in this way. So in the interval graphs, what you can easily do is that you can represent some these chain graphs between these two sets of some lines, right, in the interval. And then you just independently you can make a chain graphs arbitrarily between these two guys, so you can construct these chain graphs. But the important observation is that this is possible because the length of the interval is not restricted. So in the unit interval graphs, every interval is required to have some unit length, then you cannot do this, and then they actually have a row rank with colorings. And for the permutation graphs, you can do like this in the same way. Okay, so this is the whole thing. Okay, so we can observe that every class of admits the low rank with coloring has these two properties. So one is the Eldo-Sarge property, that every graph contains either independent set or colleague of size n to the epsilon. The epsilon only depend on the class C. So this extends the property for graphs of bounded Rehnquist. And we also have this chi-bounded property where that there is a function such that every graph in the class, the chromatic number is bounded by some this function f of w. So this also extend the property for bounded Rehnquist. Actually, for proving this, you don't need, especially for this chi-bounded property, you don't need to have a low Rehnquist coloring. For some, this low Rehnquist coloring for value 2 is sufficient. Yes, yeah, somehow. Yeah. This is just not. Okay. So what it proves is that for every fixed D, so the powers of the planar graphs of low Rehnquist coloring, and then we can generalize to the bounded expansion class. But interval graphs or permutation circle graphs do not admit low Rehnquist coloring. And somehow this was quite interesting because when you introduce this low Rehnquist coloring, somehow so we can have like a shallow concept of vertex minors or pure minors, so that maybe they're related to this. But somehow circle graphs already do not have low Rehnquist coloring, because circle graphs do not contain the field 5 as a vertex minor.
What is the circle graph?
So circle graph is that so you have some code diagram in the circle like this, where the each chord represents some vertex of the graph, and then this intersection graph of this course. Yeah. So permutation graphs is a special case of circle graphs because you can just put this end of these two lines into the circle.
I don't know what a permutation graph is.
Ah, okay, permutation. Okay. So permutation graphs are the, so you have two parallel lines, and then you have some lines.
And the intersection graph,
yeah? Yeah, intersection graphs. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Actually, we have another going on paper with several guys that we want to restrict this Rehnquist via this SC depth, where SC depth is a kind of a depth variant of the Rehnquist. And then we prove a more stronger theorem that every simple first order interpretation of bounded expansion class has a lower shear of depth color. Probably you don't know many of the notations, so I will skip this. So this is approved. This is completely approved, but there are lots of things are open. We conjecture that every class admitting low SC depth coloring can be, there is some bounded expansion class and first order interpretation, such that they represent this class. Somehow we are trying to prove this, but somehow it's difficult at this moment. Okay, so the other main open problem is that can you characterize the class of admitted low Rehnquist coloring? And then in the paper, we say that probably this twisted chain graphs are the only obstruction for having low Rehnquist coloring, but we don't have a big clue, so we just did. Yeah. Maybe there are some other obstructions for this, or maybe we can state it in the other formulation. Okay, so this is maybe a good open problem for
does
what
it mean a subgraph, large twisted chain
graphs as a subgraph.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, as a subgraph. Yes. Yeah. Okay, so the main problem is that basically what you want to do is that you imagine the map graphs and then you want to compute the row Rehnquist coloring. But this is difficult, even with this result, because we don't know how to generate these previous planar graphs. So this is some big problem. And specifically, can you prove that given a map graph, you can generate some sparse graph H and some integer R such that H R power of H contains G as an inducer graph. So we of course know that G is a induced subgraph of two powers of a plane, some planar graph. But so there is no algorithm to generate this preview. So I think there is some Stoke 1997 result about this, but people don't believe that this is true. So you generate a previous planar graph from a map graph, but somehow it's difficult. But okay, so this is some simple example, and we generally interested in that given some graph classes admitting low rank scalar ranks, you can compute some sparse graph classes and some formula such that this generate this graph in the low rank scalar in the class. This is all. Thank you.